Hey, g'day guys, it's Calvin from the Cartoon Company in New Zealand. Now I do a heap of 1uz conversions and wiring. So if you're into that sort of stuff, consider subscribing to my channel. And there's lots of other videos, helpful information, tips and tricks, conversion videos for you to watch. Now, sometimes we all need a little bit of motivation. And Mike, who this video is for, mentioned that this particular Sora, SC400, if I call them an SC400 or a Sora, to me they're the same thing. There are a couple of differences, but as far as what we're concerned, they're the same thing. Anyway, we all need a little bit of motivation. And this particular Sora, SC400, happens to be Mike's date car. Now, that's enough motivation for me. I don't want to get in the way of some guy on the other side of the world having a chance to get his rocks off. So let's try and get that car fixed so this man can enjoy adult time again. So spread around on my benches here, I have some Sora looms. I was going to compare it with a Crown loom. I happen to have a 141 Crown. I got the box here, it says 141 Crown Loom ECU. And I thought, cool, we'll check that out. It had a Crown ECU. So if I compare it to a Sora ECU, you'll notice quite a lot wider with the Crown ECU. So I thought, yep, that's Crown, good. But it's already been attacked. I could see it had one plug like that, which is typical of a, put it on the right way, shall we? Typical of a Crown. So single plug, same as a Sora, with a bolt in it, and the extra one is normally elsewhere. However, extra wires, I may have already raided that plug. There's a few control wires, and there aren't very many in there. It was traction control. It has a cold start injector, cold start injector timer, and this contraption, which leaves us probably connected to the back bumper by the length of it. That's long enough pretty much to reach the length of a car. An indication that whoever wired this one didn't quite know what they were doing. Now, normally if it was a Crown loom, we'd have a big plug like this on it. Because it's been butchered, I can't tell. Single wire oxygen sensors, which point towards Sora, but it's got a different power trigger wire to the starter motor. And that's how you remove, that's how some people remove the transmission wiring. You just cut it off and tape it up. So that one didn't really work for me, so we're just gonna scrap that. So that, I'm not sure exactly what it was. It was probably just a mix-up for someone. So we'll go over to the two Sora looms. So there's the layout of the Sora looms. They run through the center of the plenum to the cold start injector timer, to the idle speed control, and for the diagnostic box. This one is one throttle position sensor. So that is a non-traction control. Earths there, and in that plastic bracket on the back of the cylinder heads. I will be putting this onto Old Yeller and we will be firing it up. Start trigger wire comes through the back, this wire here, this plug. Now that is typical of an early Sora or SC400. With another control wire on the top of the rear wiring plastic. This one has the start loom attached as well. And the start, going into the starter motor, there's the trigger and there's the knock sensors. And the knock sensors come up through this plug on the top. Oil pressure also comes up through there. There's your oil pressure switch. So this is this normally goes to the battery. like that. So that normally goes up to the battery, air conditioning, there's an earth. The oil level sensor. We can probably just get rid of that loom. This is the loom I'm going to use for this demonstration. Plug's a bit old and brittle. Come off. Gotcha. So that's the start loom. We'll just pop that out of the way for the moment. And as far as I know, the start loom is the same on traction and non-traction. Now running around the side of the engine, around the back here, we also have this wiring with the oxygen sensor in it. Over to here. And now these are behind the fuse box. And you'll notice this is a right-hand drive car with the ECU on the left. Of course, if it's a left-hand drive vehicle, the ECU's on the other side. But they're very, very similar in looms. And the fuse box is still on the same side. So these wires here are going to be very important for us. Igniters have a 201 written on them. So that's 89621-12050. Igniters. Going to the front. Hydraulic fan. So it's got a 4-pin plug and a 6-pin for the into the crank loom. Very, very similar to a traction control. This is the traction control. There's the traction control motor plug and your two TPS plugs. Your main TPS and your sub TPS. Earths again on the back. They're a little bit more visible. Transmission loom. Oh, this is a transmission loom. A small shifter plug, shift selector, NCO, SP2, and a vehicle speed sensor, 3-pin vehicle speed, and a 6-pin solenoid plug. Again, airflow meter, alloy body, plastic insert. Now we get to the ECU plugs. You notice here that both the main, that 80 pin and the extra 40 pin, we won't use a crown one, we'll use a Sora one to make it more understandable, are all part of the main loom. And then we have lots of other plugs. And unfortunately, this one's had its extra plug cut off, which is a little bit of a pain. I'm going to use that one, so I'm going to ditch the other crown. I'm going to use the traction control. No, I'm going to use the non-traction control loom, and we're going to power it up on the bench and do a bit of testing. We'll just have a comparison here. So you'll notice here we've got the same plugs. Got the same plugs. Those are all the same, though the pinout varies a little bit. Those are the same, but that's different. That's the same plug. However, the traction control's got a different plug that one's been cut off than the non-traction control. So there's a difference there in the loom as well, where it connects into the body. Right, let's get rid of that one, and let's get stuck into this one. I may frequently say that fuses are for pussies, but I am just kidding, so if you can, do put fuses in this sort of wiring. Just another warning, the wiring I'm doing here is not how to wire a solar loom, but it is how to fire it up on the bench really quickly and how to do testing. If you wire it up in this fashion, the engine will run, but it will not run properly. So do not come back to me and say, it's not running right when I followed your instructions. These are not instructions on how to wire the engine correctly into your conversion or into your car. I have a little fuse box. Now I'm going straight to this 3-pin plug, which is over by the igniters behind the fuse box. I'm putting power into that wire there. And that will power up the idle speed control, center pins. Yes. It will power up the transmission solenoid plug. This one. There. And there. So if you remember that guy that just cut the loom off, there's live wires going down there. Good plan. I don't know if it powers that one up. No. And it powers up plus B in the diagnostic. Plus B, that one there. Going into the cabin, there is a big black red wire right here. You can notice it's very obviously big and black and red. There we go, that'll have power to it. And you'll notice I'm using a test light, not a multimeter. The reason being, this is better for amp flow. So if you've got a fuse that's blowing and it's just touching, with a multimeter, you can get 12 volts, but you don't always actually have enough amps to run what you need, the component you want to run. And in the ECU, we will have power there and there. Next, I'm going to power up the coils on injectors. So we're going into the middle pin of this plug. We will now have power and injectors. And the coil wiring is here in this front plug. So that's the 4-pin plug at the front, pin 1. And the coil plug is here, the one closest to the tag. There we go. Coils and injectors are powered. Some of the information that I'm providing in this relates to all 1uz's. So if you've got enough electrical knowledge, it converts over really well to all of the looms. I only had to really learn a couple of these looms, and once I worked out the systems that they use, they're all pretty much the same to me. All the same stuff happens in the same way, just a matter of finding the pins and getting it sorted. As such, over the years, I've learnt and I've scribbled down and written my own hieroglyphics to make them really fast for me to wire. And those are the base of the instructions which I sell. This is kind of a step on from the wiring instructions and into the diagnostics. And again, it's just knowledge of diagnostics, but also knowing what technique to apply when you're working on the ECU. If you're doing this in a car, which most people are going to be doing it in a car, you'll also want to check you've got permanent battery power at BATT. Should have power all the time. For this exercise, I'm not going to bother with that. You're also going to want to have ignition switch. So when you turn the key on, IGSW turns on and off. For this particular job, that isn't that uncritical. So we have the coils powered up, we've got the injectors powered up. I really could do with a crank loom and a coil for this next test. For the next test, I've set up my spark tester. And I've come to the ECU and I'm going to IGT, which is the trigger for the igniter. Test light is connected into power. My bench is now earth, now grounded. So I just give it a quick pulse back and forth. So that shows that the ignition system is working. You can do the same thing over at the igniter. It has the pinout for the igniter on the bottom of the plug, on the bottom of it. Might take a couple of goes just to get the pulse just right. So that's the way you can check the ignition system, really easy. As you can see here, I've plugged in some injectors. And this is one of the funny things that we have. So we go over here. I'm just going to unplug one, actually. People get their test light out, and they test there. And they got, we got power to the injector. Oh, we got power at both sides of the injector. Oh, no. Oh, no. I've got power at both sides of my injector. There must be something wrong. I'm going to set up a light bulb and do some really basic electrical theory. Sorry for the guys that know this, but there's a lot of people who still test an injector and go, oh no, there's power at both sides of the injector, there's something wrong. So here is a little bit of electrical 101, which we need to know for testing more complicated stuff like fuel injection. Basic 101, we've got voltage all the way along this line to the component. On the other side of the component, I have voltage. So I have voltage on the other way of the component all the way to the switch. I'll initiate the switch. The component now goes, if my switch was good. So I turn the switch on. The component is now going. I've got voltage all the way along to the component. But after the component is now an earth. I've just swapped my test light, so this is now reading an earth. So that is now an earth. See this side not picking up. It's getting a little bit warm on my fingers. So we have voltage all the way to the component, but nothing after the component because the component is on. Without the component on, all the way along, and then all the way to the switch. So the earth side has got voltage. Hence, when we test our injectors, we've also got these are also in group wiring. So when I touch it on there, it's also energizing the injector. So when I come back to my ECU, I've got voltage at all the injector drive outputs. I've unplugged a couple of injectors because the resistance of my test light won't allow it to fire the pair. But if I do this, I've got an injector firing, and the other one, I think it was this one. Nope, this one, nope. It was this one, I'm sure of it. There it is. Righto. We probably should look at the crank sensor wiring and do a test for that. So this is really just an LED test light. It's a little bit, it is a little bit more, but I'm using it like an LED test light. Just watch here. That's one way of testing crank triggers. I'm going to test the continuity of the crank sensor back to the ECU. So the crank sensor is NE, and it is the black wire. The crank sensor wiring comes up the crank loom and through this 6-pin plug right here. They are quite prone to getting a bit of corrosion in this plug. I don't see it heaps, but I see it enough that I acknowledge that it's a problem. So with my multimeter into there, I have continuity with the crank sensor there. And there's a ground in here somewhere too. And there's the ground. So that's really easy. So let's pop this loom onto Old Yeller, put some petrol into it, and I'll show you how little wiring you need to actually make this engine run. So remembering we're going for very little that we need to run this engine, I'm plugging the injectors in. Probably quite important. I'm plugging the front crank loom in. That's probably quite important. We're going to plug both the cam angle sensors in for the moment. We'll come back to that. We're going to plug this coil in and the crank sensor. The extra little wire on there, that's the noise suppressor. Down this side, I'm going to plug in the injectors. Just break the temp sensor plug off, as it's normally brittle. Pretty normal there. And we're going to plug this coil in. We are going to put the earth in the back. That is very important. It's one earth, and the other earth is over here. And they're a little bit harder to get at when you've got an engine in the car. There's the wiring to the airflow meter. There we have the throttle body on. Earth's on the back of the head, nice and tight. Just check all this isn't going to get burnt. Looks okay. And this bit here we are going to fit up. Bring this around. There's our power wires. And there's our igniter. So the igniter must be earthed. That looks good to me. Some battery voltage is pretty important. And an earth. The adjustable nut fucker is still the great way to do up those terminals nice and tight. And hey, I'm also a farmer. Right. I think I've almost got enough connected. Let's give it a little crank. Yep, that turns over. Let's power up the ECU. Righto, I'm going to put voltage into that wire and that wire. I probably should give it some fuel. I have my fuel pump connected, powered up, dampener screws popped up. I'm not running the start signal through the loom, but that's the third wire in that 3-pin plug. Voltage. Give me some voltage. It's getting late. Turn the voltage on. Now it is quite cold here at the moment, and this engine doesn't have a cold start. So we'll just give it some cold start enhancement. As you just saw, I connected two power wires through the loom on the engine, gave it some fuel, and it runs. See, it's cold. These are the most basicest wiring. So if you've got a sawer that's got problems, unplug everything from the car, power up the fuel pump, drop a couple of power wires in like I've done. The third wire is the starter, so run the start. And guess what? If it goes, then the problem's in the car. If it doesn't go, then the problem's in the wiring loop. Simple, eh? I'm going to do a bit of testing, but I think I'll do a couple of other videos. I'm going to do cam sensors, do a bit of an explanation there. And I'm going to turn that fuel pump off because it's making lots of noise. So I hope that was helpful. And we'll talk to you again soon. Catch you later.